Okay, well, this is part two of chapter seven, Transport Layer, part two. I didn't do a nice little graphic on this one, but this is part two. What we're going to talk about in this section is the TCP communication. We have TCP connection establishment and termination. When TCP has to, it has to make a connection because it's a connected state. It does what we call a three-way handshake. It establishes that the destination device is present on the network, and it says, "Hey, I need to send some packets to you. I need to send some information. Are you there?" It gets a return back and says, "Yes, I've verified that the destination device has an active service, and it's accepting request on the destination port number." And that initiating clients intends to use for the session, and then informs the destinating device that the source client intends to establish a communication session on that port number. So then it sends another and says, "Hey, I got your acknowledgement that you are open and ready for business, and I'm getting ready to send an acknowledgement that I received your acknowledgement." When we look at this on a Wireshark, we can see the TCP here, and we can see the port, and they've broke it down there, but it's on the 1061 port. Destination port's port 80, so they're pulling an HTTP, and it's going to come back in on the 1061 port right here. And this is another screen of it. We've got the acknowledgement here. The acknowledgement flag is set to indicate a valid acknowledgement number. The acknowledgement number response to initial sequence number is a relative value of 1. Then the SYN flag is set to indicate the initial sequence number, and then the destination port number of 1061 to the corresponding to the client source port. So basically what I'm doing is I'm sending a request to a device and saying, "Are you there? Do you have your ports open?" I'm going to get a response back saying, "Yes, I am," and then I'm going to send my next data, say, "Okay, I got your request, I got your receipt, and I'm getting ready to send packets." And so I'm going to establish a connection. And then that's the establishment of the connection. Here's another way to look at it here. A computer sends the FIN. It's received. B sends the acknowledgement of the ACK. The FIN is received. And then it sends an acknowledgement back or the ACK back that it's received. So three-way handshake. And then this one sends the acknowledgement, send in the FIN, and then the back. The sequence numbers, it uses a sequence number to reassemble the segments into the original order. Different segments may take different routes. You may have some segments go this route here, and you may have some segments because of loading. Let's say that you get some congestion on this area right here, so you send the first, I'm going to say 10 packets, and then packets 11 through 25 get routed this way, and they get routed down this way and back around, and then packets 26 and through 50 get routed back through this way. And so, but when they get there, the sequence number is what allows them to be put back in order. So TCP reorders the segments to the original order. And the sequence and the acknowledgement number are used together to confirm receipt. They use the sequence number and the acknowledgement to confirm the receipt on that. I'm just going to leave this up here for a second. The window size is a term you need to know. It's the amount of data that a source can transmit before an acknowledgement must be received. That's just your window size. When you have window size in acknowledgements, it'll look a lot like this. You'll have sequence number 1 go through. It'll send 1500 bytes. And it says, "I received 1 through 1500." And then sequence number 1501, say you receive 1501 through 3000, and then you'll get an acknowledgement. And then it will say, "Okay, I acknowledge that I've got those, or that you receive those." And then it will send 3001 to 4500, then 4501 to 6000. And then that one will, and then the receiver will send an acknowledgement, say, "Hey, I got those. I acknowledge 6001." It doesn't have to acknowledge all of them. It just has to say, I'm going to acknowledge 6001, and when I get the request, I get the receipt back for 6001, I know I started on 3001, and I know I ended on 6000. So if I get a receipt back for 6001, then yes, I know all my packets got there, and then I can send 6002, or excuse me, 6001. If one doesn't go through, if segment 3 is lost because of congestion at the receiver, it will resend it. It resends it. Or it will reduce the window size. Same thing here too. If you get a block, it'll duplicate and then it'll tell it to reestablish. Now, UDP, when we're looking at UDP, it has low overhead versus low reliability. But it's a simple protocol. It provides basic transport layer functions. It's used by applications that can tolerate small data loss. If we're streaming a video, we can tolerate a little bit of data loss. If we're sending an email, we have to have connection because we need to know all that data gets there. But for a video, let's say a phone call and a voice over IP, we can drop some of those packets because we can have a packet here or there, and we can because it's easy for us to say, hey, could you say I didn't get that last part. The proverbial, can you hear me now? It's used by DNS, SNMP, DHCP, TFTP, and voice over IP, and online gaming too, because that's how you keep your overhead down. But that's also when you get lag. If you've ever played a video game and you've been running along, or let's say Minecraft, or a shooting game or something along those lines, and then all of a sudden you warp and you're farther than you are, or somebody is that you're shooting them but they're not really there because they've already moved ahead a little bit, or they keep jumping. That's UDP and packet loss. So with UDP we have datagram reassembly. It may take different routes, and it may reassemble it out of order. So lost datagrams are not resent. It orders them the best way it can. That's why I called it the Honey Badger. It just says, hey, I got what I got. I'm going to put it together. Now, when you do the UDP server and client processes, UDP based server applications are assigned well-known port numbers. UDP client processes randomly select port numbers from the range of dynamic port numbers as the source port. So the client, I'm just going to, from the source port, it's just going to, I know I'm going to port 53, but I'm just going to randomly or semi-randomly select a source port and send that out. But when that goes out, it's going to know to send the return back to 49.152 because that was in my packet. That information was in my packet, so I know it's going to come back. Applications that use TCP, HTTP web pages, FTP when we're uploading files, SMTP mail, Telnet, those all use TCP because they need to be connection oriented. We have to know that the information got through. UDP, on the other hand, is used by DHCP, DNS, some mail on SNMP, TFTP, voice over IP, and internet. Or IPTV, excuse me. Okay, well, that was Chapter 7. We looked at the role of the transport layer. It's to provide three main functions: multiplexing, segmentation, and reassembly, and error checking. Three main and error checking. Three functions are necessary in order to address issues in a quality of service and security. Knowing how TCP and UDP operate, which popular applications, and how they use each protocol. You do need to know that, and the ports provide a tunnel for data to get to the transport layer to the appropriate application of the destination. Okay, well, that's the end of Chapter 7.